starting hobby. Liesel, author of some nice steampunk books. Talking about steampunk. I suspect that topic will turn up a lot though, because it's... So yeah, why steampunk?
I don't know. It just kind of happened, really. I'm a big Michael Moorcock fan. I've always used to have enjoyed his books, mostly because I like to read his books while trying to guess how many drugs he took. no offence to Michael Moorcock.
No, I think you're right. I've read his stuff. That's what he writes when he comes down.
Yeah. And so I've always kind of had this New York tour, and I've always been fascinated by the 19th century, and I've always loved books of 19th century literature. So, it was kind of a confluence of these things, and one day on a Tuesday afternoon, you know, on the Metropolitan line going through Baker Street, a scene popped into my head, as it does, and these characters were having an almighty row, and I thought, oh, that's cool, I should write that down. And it then kind of just grew into a story, and I thought, no, this needs to be in the 19th century, and I thought, well, this has actually got the legs for a steampunk novel. It kind of just organically grew into it, and you know, I kind of am a science fiction and fantasy writer, or I consider myself to be a science fiction and fantasy writer. So you know, steampunk is just one aspect or one facet of what you do, and that just happened to be the one that was successful. So that's how I came to be here.
So, what's your fan
background? Most of everything, really. I kind of grew up with sort of high fantasy stuff, you know. I love things like Diana Wynne Jones' books and Owen Moody's Castle and that kind of thing. I also grew up reading Rosemary Sutcliffe as well, so I was massively interested in history. And I was one of those geeky children who would spend the afternoons reading the encyclopedias, because, you know, I don't know, you know, they've disappeared now, but, you know, when I was little, we had this sort of massive bank of encyclopedias in the, on the shelf, you know, and I sort of started at A and got stuck at E. You know, the Egyptians was a particularly well-found volume. And so it kind of grew from there, you know, and, you know, just a general confluence of stuff, fantasy, bit of science fiction chucked in, a bit of Star Wars, a bit of Star Trek, big Joss Whedon fan in the 90s.
You've got a lot of friends here.
Yes. And, yeah, you know, the stuff, and sort of thrown into that a bit of history and a bit of, everything you can imagine. You know. My brain pan is a very interesting and eccentric place.
So, your accent's definitely not English.
I was born in South Africa, but my dad was German. So, I sort of suffer from origin schizophrenia. Yes. So I have a German name and a South African accent, but I've been here for, you know, over a decade, so I consider the UK to be my home. So if you'll let me, I'd like to stay.
Anybody else? Yeah. It's the German invasion.
So I identify as British, but I have a multicultural background.
Any questions?
Do you think having a multicultural background makes it easier to envision fictitious cultures?
I think having a multicultural background gives you a wider worldview, just as travelling does. You know, the more exposure you have to different people, the wider your perception of the world becomes. I think definitely so. I think it's given me an insight into understanding the differences and appreciating the differences between people. You know, we're not just a homogenous society of one type of people. We come in all shapes and sizes and all kinds of interests and things. I think my passion for travel kind of led into the books, and that's why they shift locations so often. most of the places, in fact, all of the places that appear in the books I visited. So all in the name of research, of course.
So, the heroines in your book, Airship, is a MacGuffin to go to these nice places?
Well, no. Don't tell my accountant. in London and end up in Paris, and they sort of keep going until they turn around. And I ended up in a big old bus with, I think, 80 Australian and New Zealand tourists. So that was quite fun. And, my goodness, they can drink. And so, yeah, you know, so we went from one country to the next, and, you know, it was kind of like wake up and go, oh, it's Tuesday, so it must be Czechoslovakia, you know, or the Czech Republic. And so, yeah, you know, so I went to all of these places and, you know, wandered around with my camera and took lots of pictures, and, you know, that always stayed with me. So once I, when I started writing the book, the first book, I thought, oh, they need to go somewhere, you know, but this book needs to travel. And so I just thought, oh, well, I've been there, let me write about that. And, oh, I've been there too, let me write about that. So it just kind of happened, you know. So I hadn't planned the book and then went travelling. I kind of went travelling and then wrote the book.
That's what you tell me, Jan.
Yeah. And then when I was writing the second one, The Clockwork Heart, I was actually working in the city at the time. And so every lunchtime I would get up and go, I just want to go and check whether I'm just going to go and look for a place where I can murder someone. So I sort of wander around the back streets of London, the city of London, looking for alleyways that would be suitable to dump bodies.
What writer hasn't?
Yes. So,
you do know you're allowed to make places up, don't you? They did explain that.
Yes. Although I do like giving my books a little bit of a factual backbone. I find it just gives it a little bit more credence, you know. And I like the fact that there is an alley just off Aldgate, you know, about two blocks away from Aldgate Tube Station, where the old Saracen's Head Inn used to be, that exists, you know. And you know, so when my characters hide there, it really is there, you know, and it was there in the 19th century. So I kind of like that about books. When you can't really tell what's real and what isn't. Also, never ever Google how to conduct a satanic ritual on your work computer. IT people get very upset when you Google. So does HR.
Of course, I'm now going to go and Google how to conduct a satanic ritual on your work computer over lunch.
Yes. Also, never ever Google how to tie somebody up on your work computer.
Speaking as an IT person, we find that HR gets more involved. We just Google it as well.
Yeah, to be fair, most IT people I know are that geeky. Pat's probably the only person who can get away with Googling that and not being in trouble.
We got a web search blocked by our IT department. We tried to search in and it came up, your access to this site has been blocked. We rang up IT. We ran a search, we got your stupid blocker. What does it say? It said, we have blocked access to this site because of sex. So, what did you search for? Sex. We're a genetics research institute. It's a word we use quite a lot.
It's a conveyancing story. I qualified as a lawyer years ago before I became a writer. I'm okay now, but you know, I am actually a lawyer as well. There was a firm of conveyancers who had an overzealous IT guy who, you know, also blocked a whole lot of search terms. Amongst them was the word erection, which, if you're a conveyancer, is a very important word. Because, you know, this appears on many title deeds, and it actually caused massive amounts of problems for their business, because emails were blocked and deleted that were sent with attachments that, you know, had the word erection in it. And, you know, we are sitting in an erection. Yeah, so it happens.
I wouldn't be in a stool in the science department. I googled slime and got blocked. Mucus was fine. Slime was blocked. Anyway, a question for the audience.
Okay, for very brief anecdote, somebody doing north of England had a search for scumball blocked. But the question Do you have a definition of style steampunk you use?
No. I think steampunk is, you'll see it, you'll recognise it when you see it. It's notionally, I think for steampunk you have to have steam and you have to have punk. And when I say that, I don't mean it flippantly. I mean you have to have something that is steam-based technology. It has to be, you know, either Victorian or Edwardian or pre-First World War or whatever, but it's got to be in the future or, you know, I don't know, whatever floats your boat or your airship. And, yeah, as long as it's steam-driven, and it has to have that punk element. And I think a lot of steampunk today doesn't actually have the punk element to it, which is the subversiveness, the... you know, the sort of sticking it to the man and the turning the history upside down and, you know, making it what you want it to be. So yeah, I think that's the closest thing I can get to in terms of the definition. But yeah, it could be anything you want it to be, and I think that's the fun part of it, you know. Because people are so wonderfully creative, both in terms of the aesthetic side of things as well as the literary side.
So, let's go to your books. You've got three books.
Yes.
Tell us about your three books.
Oh, I hate this question.
They want to know. They will then go out and buy all the books that you've got in the dealer's room.
Yes.
At a very reasonable price.
Yes. Well, basically, it is an Edwardian steampunk adventure story featuring Eleanor Toms, who is an aviatrix. Oh, no. It's fine. I just thought that. I was just thinking something that was those the voices of my own head? she's an aviatrix, and it starts off in Paris, and you know, she's a woman in a man's world, and she starts off in Paris, and she gets herself into a whole lot of trouble, and she meets up with the enigmatic Mr. Hugh Marsh, and together they end up setting off on a long and interesting adventure that sort of spans three books. So the first one's called A Conspiracy of Alchemists, the second one is A Clockwork Heart, and the third one in the series is called Sky Pirates. So, and I don't know if I can say any more, because otherwise we'll just fall.
Yeah, very good. And very reasonably priced in the industry.
I shall be there to sign later. You can get your money back on eBay afterwards.
That's why I get mine dedicated, because they're worth so much less. Though.
Yes.
So now I'm independent in the kind of format.
The first one actually won the Joan Hessian Award for the best debut novel in 2013, 2014. Big thanks to the Romantic Novelists Association.
So in fact, the Romantic Novelists are awarding you things that the science fiction ones aren't.
Well, yes. I became a member of the RNA when I was still studying, when I was a student doing my MA in creative writing. And to be fair, the RNA, I've always been a bit of a softie, and I've always loved a bit of romance. You know, I mean, who doesn't? Cold people. I was part of their new writers scheme, and the RNA is such a wonderful, warm, and amazing group of people, and they give their new writers such support. So I would highly recommend that if any of you are thinking about joining the Writers Association, do join the RNA, because it's just lovely. And so, they gave me lots of support while I was sort of still, you know, learning how to write, and it was a real honour to be recognised, and today I'm still a proud member of the
audience. But especially the first one, it is a romance novel.
Yes.
It is a love story between two of the characters. All the other stuff, the end of the world and that stuff happens around them, two of them, and that romance.
Yes. Which, sprang out of the argument between the two characters, and that kind of ended up evolving. But strangely enough, lots of men read the books and come back and say to me they really enjoyed them. So, you know, romance is not just for girls. Mm-hmm.
Questions?
I was interested in your observation that steampunk basically doesn't like being mainstream, yet it has become mainstream. Have you actually tried to marry the two, or are you kind of sitting on the sidelines and keeping out of that one?
The problem is that I think the issue is very political. Mm. And if you go online and you look at forums and you know, discussions between steampunks, there are two big topics, big hot sensitive topics in the aspect, you know, within steampunk. And the first is you know, obviously the legacy of colonialism and all that goes with that. And secondly, it's this should we or shouldn't we go mainstream debate. It gets very heated, it gets very, you know, people are very vehement about these topics. And for me as an author, I make art, you know, I write the books and I put them out there, and you can choose to read them or not, you can choose to like them or not. I have no control over how you feel about these things, but I write the books as they appear in my mind, for me, effectively, and that kind of is as far as I'll go in terms of the debate, because I don't think it's my place to become involved, you know. So if you identify as a steampunk, then those are the issues that you can resolve within yourself, you know. And yeah, also I think there's no answer, so, you know, I don't know.
There's never a hard and fast rule to any genre, I think, because especially at the edges it blurs. I got into a couple of steampunk music bands, and there's one called The Men Will Not Be Blamed for Nothing.
Yeah.
And my experience is most steampunk music comes from the goth side.
Yes.
People that have Abbey Park, which are really good, I love them. But then I read The Men Will Not Be Blamed for Nothing. If you haven't heard them, there's lots of it on YouTube. And they come in from the punk side.
Yes.
They are basically punk singers. And you go, okay, that's what it's supposed to be.
Yes, yes. And there's, of course, Professor Elemental.
Yes.
Yes,
you know,
yes.
The gentleman rapper. So, you know, it really is whatever you want it to be. I think there's so much you can do. So. Yes.
More questions? Okay, what's next?
Lots of things, actually. I'm busy with book number 4 in the series. There will ultimately, I think, be 5 books. We're still sort of negotiating with my publishers. And I'm busy finishing off a novel which is more fantasy. Sort of, I needed a little bit of, after 3 full-on steampunk novels, I needed a little bit of a break from the genre. So I've got sort of 2 books in the pipeline that are, the one is sort of pure dystopian science fiction, and the second one is more historical and more sort of high fantasy. So those are in the pipeline. I've just finished a short story for an anthology which I'm doing with Chuck Wendig and Warren Ellis, which will be out next year, called Haunted Futures, by the lovely Ghostwood Books. And I'm very proud to say that it is one of the first formally Kickstarter or crowdfunded anthologies that has come out. And we've had a massive amount of support from people. So my story will be appearing in that. And you know, so there's lots of stuff involved. I've just finished a contribution to a Doctor Who anthology on the Iron Wild Time storyline with Paul Mars and George Mann, which was great fun. Absolutely bonkers. I mean, I sort of gave my story to my partner to read, and he read it and he was like, okay, so how many drugs did you take? He didn't, I promise. I've been asked by Tyson Books to write a Sherlock Holmes story, which needs to be in by the end of the year. Yes, so I've been working on that as well. So lots of little things, you know, we'll see what. It's all kind of you know, under negotiation at the moment, so I can't say too much, but so lots of stuff from me in the near future.
When he wakes up, we'll put you in touch base with Andy Lane, who's written Young Sherlock Holmes.
Yes.
That's his stuff at the moment. So yeah, we'll talk Sherlock Holmes with another fan.
Yeah. When you said Sherlock Holmes, which one? Are we talking Jeremy Brent time Victorian, or are we talking Cumberbatch modern?
We're talking writing a traditional Sherlock Holmes in the Conan Doyle style.
Yes.
I don't know if I should tell you secret. From the sub character. character's point of view. So anybody's point of view but Holmes or Watson. It's going to be a completely different point of view shift. But
I was interested in what you said, that you would thought that the current series would end at 5 books. Do you have a general story arc for the series, or is it just a matter of keeping on going until you seem to find a natural resting point for the characters?
I started with one book, and I realised that there was too much story for one, so I thought, okay, it would be 3. And then when we sort of started, my publisher started getting involved, and they actually said to me, actually, there's enough story for 5, can you stretch it into 5? So I was like, oh, I'm not too keen to do that. And then sort of halfway through the second book, I realised, actually, I have enough material to do another 3 books. So, it kind of just sort of happened that way. I've always had a general plot arc idea, which I could adapt to cover 5 books instead of 3 fairly easily. So, which is quite good.
So you know what's going to happen to your heroes?
I'm still, ish.
When you write, you have a plan and you know exactly and you know what the end's going to be and you work through it, or do you just write and see where they go?
I do a bit of both. I outline. So I'll do I know some authors, use flashcards and post-its and Excel spreadsheets, which terrify me, and they plot their novels in the most minute detail. I find that too restrictive. It just kills my creativity. So what I do is I write a global outline of the book, and I literally take an A4 piece of paper and a sort of school essay style. I write the story longhand as I would be telling it to myself, so no dialogue or anything like that. And I literally write sentences like, and then this happens, and then that happens, and arrow, insert large explosion here, and that kind of thing. And then once I have a workable outline with a sort of notional ending and a beginning and a middle, then I start breaking it up into chunks, and then I write the chunks into chapters, and then that becomes the first draft. At that point, if I want to make changes, it's fairly easy to move stuff around. And then once I have first draft, then I start polishing and adding things in and so on. So it's sort of a loose structure, but necessary in order to make sure that you have a coherent novel that doesn't have missing plot lines and things.
Just notice when you were talking there about the structure, you said you have an end and middle and beginning.
Yes.
Not beginning, middle and end. So is that how you think? You start at the end?
No, I start at the beginning, but I kind of have to know what roughly where I'm. I don't need to know. It's like climbing a mountain. You kind of need to know where the peak is, because if you don't, you might end up, falling off the side somewhere. Especially when it gets a bit foggy and you don't know what you're doing. So I kind of need to know roughly what the route is and what direction I'm going in. And once I get to the end, I know, this is what happens, I get all the detail, but I have to sort of notionally know where I'm writing, otherwise it just becomes a nightmare. And I think a lot of authors become very overwhelmed when they're writing if they don't have a goal at the end that they should be trying to reach. I start with the beginning. Usually I have an idea for an opening, and then I just work it from there. I sort of use the reverse because when I've written the outline, I sort of have a rough idea where I'm going to, and then I can sort of plot it back to make sure I know the route.
So what are you reading at the moment?
Interestingly enough, I'm busy teaching a course on genre fiction at Bath Spa University, and so at the moment I'm very busy reading the set work for the course. I've just finished reading The Ninth Life of Louis Drax, which is quite interesting.
I like normal universities these days.
Yeah, true.
It's all about the student experience.
Yeah. My students are super talented, though. I'm very proud of them, and they're doing very good work, so I'm very excited about the stuff that they're doing. And it's quite interesting that universities are now actually finally recognising genre. You know, they're finally recognising that science fiction and fantasy and horror are, you know, recognisable bodies of literature, and you know, they're finally recognising that the genre writers are also talented and can produce work of a high quality. And so, you know, for me, it's extremely exciting to see that, you know, we're not just all reading literary fiction at university now and, you know, having pretentious discussions about them. We're actually looking at genre and we're looking at training people to being writers who are commercially successful. You know, and that's good, I think that's a fantastic thing. So, in science fiction and fantasy has been scoffed at for too long. It's good that we're out and proud.
Many science fiction and fantasy novels tend to lurk at the top of bestseller lists. Terry, you know, every book goes right to the top, and he was a fantasy writer. Anne McCaffrey, when she was doing stuff, and she was a science fiction writer.
Ian Banks,
yeah. Then he snuck in under the radar half the time. Yeah, you didn't realise you were reading science fiction.
Yes, well, yes. So, I mean, yeah, George R. R. Martin, I think I read some ridiculous statistic that, 80% of all the highest grossing films and books of all time had a science fiction or a fantasy element. But don't quote me, I'm sure I have it wrong.
Yeah, no, I think it is right. I think most of the big bestsellers have been science fiction fantasy.
Yeah. So, yeah, Lord of the Rings, Harry Potter.
I'm distracting it all. That's an only carry on.
I'm sure I closed my eyes in that one.
When you get to choose a book to read, do you try and choose something away from where you're writing at the time, or do you try and, or do you just go, that one looks interesting, I'll read that? How do you choose?
I'm a bit of a book hoarder. I am. When I moved house a couple of years ago, we lived down a footpath so that you can't drive up to the front door of my house. And so the poor mover guys had to sort of lug these like boxes and boxes full of books into the new house. And after box number 12 or something, the guy looked at me and said, "Have you never heard of an Amazon Kindle?" So I started off with a couple of to-be-read books that then became a to-be-read shelf, which has now become like a to-be-read room. And I get lots of free books as well from going to conventions and so on. And, you know, friends ask me to read books. And, you know, so I have loads of books. And whenever I can't resist a bookshop, so whenever I go anywhere, I end up buying
again,
box.
I think you're at home here. I don't know if there's anyone.
And unfortunately, I'm a bit of a promiscuous reader, so I'll start reading one book, and I read as a writer, so I'll start reading one book, and then I stray to another one, and then I have like three or four or five of them on the go, you know, at the same time. And when I'm writing, I find I read a lot of non-fiction as well, because there's lots of research that needs to be done. So it really just depends on what day of the week it is, to be honest.
I write secondary novels, sort of steampunk fantasy. Do you think it's always been a bit of a novel situation, because a lot of the steampunk that I've read or looked at has been set in actual, the real world, but different. But I deliberately took mine into a parallel world because I wanted to write my own history, didn't want the First World War getting away, didn't want the Victorian colonial experience per se. But do you think that as time goes on, things are diversifying a bit into secondary world, maybe Victorian fantasy rather than just medieval fantasy and so on? Do you think that area is growing, or do you think that there's still a way to go in?
I think you should write what you want,
yes.
And you should write what works for you.
Yeah.
My books are set in an alternative history. I do quite a lot of research and I try and sort of anchor it into real events and people, but it's set in a completely separate world where everything that's in the 19th century literature, Gothic literature, is true. So, you know, it's an alternative history. And yeah, I think the sort of traditional Victorian steampunk set in smoky London in 1850 is becoming a bit hackneyed, you know, because everybody does it. So I think if you know, people are looking at things that are fresh and new and, you know, set in different locations and, you know, looking at different aspects of history and so on. So, yeah, I think certainly there's an appetite for that. And, you know, quite honestly, it doesn't matter what you write, as long as you write a really good book, no one's going to care, you know. I think that's, the general rule of thumb. Make sure it's a good story.
Okay, no question. So, how do you drink that?
Very carefully. It's quite funny, actually.
This was at the bottom of the advertising stuff.
I am on this very same Saint bus tour. I ended up in the Czech Republic, and you know, as they do, they sort of bus you around from tourist attraction to tourist attraction. And I was essentially just really lazy because I just wanted to kind of get on the bus and be ferried around, and I didn't really want to think too much. I just wanted to, you know, have a little bit of an adventure. And so, you know, obviously schedules allowing, and you know, all these kinds of things. As fate would have it, we ended up visiting the absinthe factory at 9 o'clock in the morning on the breakfast. And I have this very sort of distinct memory of standing in their tasting room drinking absinthe with the taste of toothpaste still strong in my mouth. You know? You can do, there's so many ways to do it. You can have it with this sort of spoon, and you can light it, and you can, you know, drop the sugar cube in there, and it caramelizes, and you know, it goes all cloudy, and it sort of looks like something that you know, you rinsed your watercolor paintbrushes out in, which is fine, you know. Or you can drink it neat. It just really depends. Or you can mix it into a cocktail. It just depends on which one it is. Every time I finish one of these books, my editor buys me a bottle of absinthe, so I have three slightly opened bottles of absinthe in my house. Everyone who comes to visit is also terribly afraid, you know, that I might break it out again and go and have some absinthe.
So this explains the fact.
Yes. Well, it was quite interesting because when I was sort of looking at the Paris cafe culture and you know, the Belle Epoque and you know, everything that was going on at the time, sort of in 1903 in Paris, because it was a wonderfully interesting and innovative time. It was sort of before we became bogged down in the sort of established ideas that we have now. You know, it was before Freud, and it was before Jung, and you know, everything was kind of really experimental because nobody really knew what was science and what wasn't. So so there was so much stuff going on that was so interesting. And art and, you know, expression and all these sort of things. And at the time, there was, you know, I looked at a lot of ephemera as well, and specifically advertisements or advertisements. And particularly the absinthe advertisements really caught my imagination because they literally had the sort of bottle with fairy, you know, floating around, and all kinds of really interesting artwork around that. And I thought, you know, that would be a really interesting thing, that if, you know, what if the fairy was real and, you know, she existed and you know, did terrible things to men's minds. And so that's how she kind of came into being, because of clever French advertising.
So now you're going to have to go and read the books, aren't you? Which is what the fairy was all about.
Actually, now I'm going to have to try some absinthe.
I believe the books are quite good when you drink absinthe and then read them.
So basically you're saying you're better off reading your books drunk.
I think most books benefit from
that. To be fair, yeah. Any questions? Got to be some out there.
How long have you actually been writing? And I mean, you went through your training, obviously, and you say you did an MA.
Yes.
How long have you been writing before you got published?
I've been inventing stories since I can remember. I have very distinct childhood memories of building fairy kingdoms in my mother's sort of 1970s rockery, you know, trampling her succulents and, you know, her alpines, you know, putting my dollies around and building the sort of fantasy world where, you know, these fairies were living. So, you know, I've always been making up stories and, you know, since I could hold a crayon, I've always been sort of writing them down. My first short story was published when I was 17. It was a profoundly angst-ridden affair involving sting lyrics, you know, as you do. And yeah, I suppose, you know, the pressures of getting a real job sort of were upon me, and so I went to university and I studied law, and kind of started working, but I never kind of gave up on it. I signed up for my MA because I wanted to join I'd done a writing workshop and I thoroughly enjoyed it, and I wanted to keep, you know, being part of a writing workshop. And at the time, this was still in the days before education became so ridiculously expensive. The cost of joining several writing groups and doing writing courses was the same as doing an MA. And as fate would have it, Brunel University was 5 minutes from my house. So I applied and got in, and I was really lucky because I ended up studying with these amazing writers, you know, and I had the great privilege of having Faye Weldon as my tutor, you know.
Wow.
So hence the strong feminist element in them. And, you know, a lot of my teachers have actually become, Celia Brayfield is another one, and you know, Danusha Keen, and, you know, all of these lovely women. And so, yeah, they're still friends today, and, you know, colleagues, and it's really nice. You know, so it was just a really amazing experience and a sort of happy happenstance. And A Conspiracy of Alchemists was actually my MA dissertation.
Mm-hmm.
So I sort of finished the book, and I was very lucky it got published. So.
You were saying early on that, unlike quite a lot of the steampunk genre, which seems to fix itself pretty much on the British Empire, your heroine bounces all over the world. Do you think that other writers will find a catch on that we might be able to do something, say, Victorian New York, or Victorian Berlin, or Victorian Paris? Because they do seem to be set a lot. This is always fixation on the British Empire.
There's a lot of steampunk out there that is not set in London. Sherry Priest writes steampunk that I think her book Bone Shaker was set in the Klondike, which is sort of in Alaska. Paolo Gagigalupi's, I can never say his name.
You can only say that right after a pint.
Yeah. The Wind Up Girl is set in a futuristic Thailand. I mean, there's loads of books that are not set in London. So certainly I think there is an awareness, and you just have to hunt around a little bit and have a look. But there are definitely sort of non-London-centric steampunk, very good steampunk books.
Do you have a favourite character that you've invented?
I don't know, I'm just trying to think. Lots of them. In fact, a lot of the gadgets I didn't invent, I actually found them in the patent section of the British Library, because you actually cannot make it up, you know, the stuff that the sort of Victorian inventors patented at the time. One I didn't use in the book, which I thought was magic, was a little steam-powered salt and pepper set in the shape of a model train. And if you can imagine sort of a Downton Abbey style dining room table that's, you know, obviously passing the salt and pepper is a rather complicated, you know, to get up and walk for a few days to get to who was asking for it. So what it was a little silver train track that ran round in an oval around the table, and it had a lovely little silver locomotive that you could obviously ran on steam, with a little carriage for pepper and a little carriage for salt. And it would go round and round on the table, and people could help themselves to seasoning as they put it on.
That's a nice idea.
Yeah. So, yes, I think that's very cool.
That's really cool.
Can you imagine being able to press a signal and it stops straight at your station?
Yes!
You could have a real gravy train.
That's
your favourite steampunk weapon. I just think you're out shooting somebody, isn't it?
A Scott should be a ray gun. I mean, you have to have a ray gun, or at least a blunderbuss that shoots like some sort of accelerator particles of sorts. That would be very cool.
Well, Tesla was working on one. Oh, is it right here?
Yes.
Well, the Americans probably don't.
Have you seen Winter Workshop's selection of weaponry, the steampunk?
I may have. The name itself doesn't ring a bell, but I'm very sure I must have seen it somewhere.
Dr.
Grogberg.
Yes. In fact, I am the proud owner of some of his work. His books,
wow.
His books, not his. And I was very privileged to go to San Diego Comic Con in 2013, which was one of the ultimate writer experiences. Was at the book signing, people actually showed up dressed, cosplaying characters.
It is comical. That's when you know you've reached that writer level.
Yes, so that was really cool. So he had a display at Comic Con, which was incredible. They were under like that much glass, so no one could touch them, but it was very cool. Yeah.
If you could ever get to New Zealand and go to the workshop proper, I can't remember the number of bugs we called, but it's all on display there, and you can. There's no glass. You can touch. And the price is awful, but the imagination is wonderful. just have to think to yourself, it's not real. It's not real. No, I won't disintegrate if I look at it.
You may have to start writing the next one.
I might. It's just so far.
Then go for research. Go for research.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do research.
That's research.
You get somebody to show you where to go.
You've got a research assistant, yeah?
There we go, yes. Yes, we'll see what happens.
So you say you're well travelled and a lot of back. What's the fan scene like around West? I don't know how old you were when you left that back. Were you involved in science fiction and fantasy or reading it then?
The fanzine is a little bit different in South Africa because I think the country is so multicultural. And I think because of, you know, many, you know, a long history of, you know, cultural isolation, you don't really get, well, you certainly not when I was a teenager, you don't get the sort of large conventions like you do here. And, you know, the costs of flying to London or America to visit them are sort of prohibitively expensive. So fandom is kind of more of a small groups of people who are fans of things rather than, you know, the sort of larger groups that you see in Europe. Obviously fans in America are incredible. I mean, the amount of time and effort they spend on costumes and things is just, you just can't believe how amazing it is. It just depends, you know. It's quite strange. I think people who are into science fiction and fantasy always tend to find one another, no matter where they are in the world. And maybe we have like this, attraction to each other. So, Fandar, there we go. There's a word. I knew there would be a word.
Well, if there is, I'm just
Yes, so Fandar. And so wherever you go in the world, you'll probably bump into people who are like-minded. So.
I sat on buses as well.
Was that the one going to Eastercon?
You can normally.
Were you
tell
just pointing at the Klingons?
Yeah, I wasn't going very high on.
It's quite funny. Last year at WorldCon, I came into London and I came in at Paddington, so I took the Heathrow Express to get to Radisson or Nine Walls. And as I got onto the train, I sort of looked around and I was like, fan.
Yeah, I was going to Salute one year. The DLR was down, so we were all busing in from. And as you got closer, you could start to see fan. And it went
fans were quite a low percentage. As you got closer and closer, the fan concentration increased. But you can recognise fans even walking down the street.
Keith, who used to come here, tells a tale that there was going to a con in London, and they didn't know quite where the hotel was, so they were stopping people asking, do you know where such hotel is? No. Have you seen a lot of science fiction fans? Oh no. And eventually one of them went, I know how to answer the question. Have you seen a lot of guys in black t-shirts with beards? Oh yeah, they're all the way there.
Yeah, I found I have a stereotype for more than one of me.
Stereotype is changing.
Women in black t-shirts with beards.
Also works for reenactment, by the way.
Certainly the fan. I think, and that's what I love about science fiction and fantasy fans, is they are so warm and welcoming and so inclusive, you know, because it doesn't matter how old you are or how, you know, what colour you are, or, you know, whether you're disabled, or, you know, how you identify, you know, whether you're male or female, or, you know, neutral, or, you know, whatever, it doesn't matter, you know, we're all here because we love science fiction and fantasy, and you don't see that in any other sort of genre, really, and that's really cool, I think. I'm very proud to be part of it. Geek and out and proud, as they say. I'm out.
Can't not in here, can you?
Yes.
But that's an interesting thing. It's the one of the things, I'm sure we've all done it, we've all seen it the first time at a convention. Because when you start off as a fan, you're on your own. You're hiding it from everyone. And then you go to a convention, you go, I can be myself.
It's quite funny because I'm out as a geek, certainly, but my partner isn't. And it's hilarious because he was at one of my signings at Forgotten Planet in Shaftesbury Avenue in London. And he was kind of mooching around, because for him it's rather boring to stand there and actually sign books and talk to people. So he was kind of mooching around, and he disappeared. So I finished my signing and started looking for him, and I found him sort of behind a shelf, and he was like, "I have a Star Wars Bible." And I was like, "Okay, we're going home now."
Well, next time.
Be nice or something, yeah.
I mean, you can do it.
He likes Star Wars, he can't do that.
Yeah. No, he's not
Star Wars.
He's on the first step.
Oh, he is a Star Wars expert. I mean, you could ask him anything and he would tell you.
Then he's already geeking.
He just needs to understand.
He's just in the closet, yeah.
He's in denial.
He's in denial.
He's in denial.
He's in denial.
He's
in denial. He's in denial.
He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial.
He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial.
He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. He's in denial. Any more questions?
Hang on, was that your trophy for Cards of Humanity?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
No.
I won it last year. I'm here to defend my title.
So last night was just a warm up.
Last night was just a warm up, yeah. We weren't playing to the professional rules.
Professional. What, no random carousel?
So, any more questions? We've got loads of time.
Please ask.
So I just saw some notes.
I'm just scratching something.
Are you thinking doing an RPG based on your books?
Not until now.
personally, no. But go for it if you want. Yes, absolutely. If you want to work with me to invent a game, I'm sure we can sort it out. Yes, I'm more than happy to consider multimedia crossovers. No problem.
It's an interesting book. Have you read the book yet? Mm-hmm. It's an interesting book because there's the steampunk, there's the magic element. I think actually it would lend itself at some point, especially by the time you've really finished book five and you've completed your work. Maybe it's something worth thinking about.
Oh yeah, absolutely. The problem is just to get games designers to listen to you, and to kind of get hold of them. And I think in a way, I know, you know, Black Library does that very well with the, what's it called, it's too early in the morning and I haven't had enough absence yet. Warhammer series, amongst others, where they do the crossover between games and fiction really well. I think there's a sort of fundamental gap between publishing of books and publishing of games, and it's sometimes quite difficult to bridge the gap to get people to cross over.
There are some. There's a lot of TV role playing there. There are some books, although Weiss and Hickman did it the other way around. They took the role playing and then turned that into books.
Yes, but it's quite difficult to get people in the publishing world who publish books to think in terms of gaming. You know? And certainly I have broached the subject and they all go, oh yes, well, you know, and unless you're George R. R. Martin or Tolkien, where you've got, you know, monumentally huge sales where they then go, okay, well, you know, here's a spare £100,000 to spend on games or whatever. I don't know what the answer to that is. The system, there's a big gap in the system and I don't know how we can reach it.
Do you ever see your 5 second book once completed ever being turned into, say, a short TV series or a movie?
Oh, I'd love it. If anyone from HBO is listening, please contact my agent. Happy to have lunch. Of course. I mean, you know, what writer wouldn't? Fantastic if that happens. It's steampunk. And unfortunately, the thing with steampunk is that most steampunk films that have been made have not been commercially successful. So it's very difficult to get directors and producers to take the risk. It's the whole steampunk paradox.
What about movies and such? Like, do you draw any, have you got any favourite movies or ones that you think basically that would be a good plot for?
Again, I think everything I watch and everything I read kind of falls into this cauldron of ideas in my head. I think it would be a bit of a bit unethical to take a film plot and then just write a book based on it. But certainly, you know, there's loads. I mean, I think it would be a matter for psychoanalysis to sit down and say, you know, what exactly inspired the book, because there's so much, you know, and I'll take a bit from here and I'll take a bit from there, you know, and I don't just watch science fiction and fantasy, I'll watch all kinds of things, box sets and, you know, films and, you know, sometimes really old films or, you know, TV series. It just really depends. Things pop in my head randomly, really. But of course, basic story structures and things, I think everybody borrows from that because they work.
Everybody borrows from me. Boy meets girl, girl meets boy, falling in love, fall out of love, live happily ever after. Basically, all stories fall within that.
There are only seven stories, guys. World.
Exactly. Well, I've never actually done the mental exercise, but apparently someone told me that if you took the plot of Star Wars, the very first one, and Harry Potter's very first novel, and you put the two plots on top of one another and just substituted Luke Skywalker for...
There's an internet meme in that.
The two of them work exactly the same, you know, it's the same plot line. Different world, different characters. So, the reason why is because they work, and it's a strange one because I think it's the whole art imitating life and life imitating art discussion, where films have been written in such a way that, and we've been so conditioned to expect that if you deviate from that formula, people are profoundly disappointed. You know?
Yeah.
So it's an interesting one. You know, and yeah, I mean, the human brain has been hard. I mean, what makes us human is the capacity to tell and listen to stories. It's what's ensured our survival as a species, because that's how we learn. In sort of Neolithic times, when we sort of mastered language, the first thing we did was say, did you hear what happened to Zork and the tiger? And everyone went, no, tell us. And that's how we learned, you know. So everybody learned, well, you know, do not tickle, you know, do not approach a tiger when it's hungry, because, you know, bad things will happen. And that is how our brains evolved, so that we, yeah. So telling stories is what we do. It's how we've been hardwired to tell stories and to listen to stories. And that's why books and cinema and television is so successful, because that's what our brains want. I mean, you know, look at soap operas. I mean, if you look at them sort of clinically, they are quite idiotic, aren't they? And yet, you cannot stop watching them. It's because we want to know what happens next, and, you know, we want to learn from each other as primates, you know, on a very basic biological level.
I know what I've learned about soap opera. Of course, there's a body under every single patio.
Yes.
Yes.
And then you'll forget to mark that hair for more than one. Probably that's just life, isn't it? Maybe. Then everything in your background.
No,
you
no,
were
no,
saying
no.
About the seven lines of the movie. Have you noticed the moves that always stick out? The most interesting is where they drop out of that. Prime example, Empire Strikes Back, the bad guys win. Blade Runner, at the end, you're actually rooting for Batty. Because you know he's actually the one with the real mission.
Yes. But the thing is, Blade Runner is a noir film, so they're just sticking to the conventions of noir, you know. So it's just a different variation on the seven basic plots. But yeah, you know, it is very interesting how that works. And the twists that people, the variations and the twists that they come up with that still bring forth a satisfying experience. I'm going to be very controversial now and say that I'm becoming profoundly disappointed with cinema at the moment. And it's because of 3D. I hate 3D. And it's almost as if, and I will say this because with authority, because I have recently watched Mad Max, Jurassic Park, and the latest Terminator film. And it seems that movie directors now, because of the whole 3D experience, are sacrificing story for the sake of large explosions and scenes. And so specific genre films are now becoming sort of a case of all thunder and no trousers.
Mad Max has pretty much always been.
Well, yeah. Mad Max had no plot
yeah.
in 2D.
Yeah.
Or indeed 1D.
That's what's
about that.
Yeah,
yeah,
but I thought
that
Mad
Max was actually Tale of Redemption.
Yeah.
Mad Max was Tale of Revenge, and I'm sorry.
And it had
yeah.
a cast from soap opera, so it's great.
Mad Max, the storyline in Mad Max, suits 3D.
Yes.
But in so many films, it's how do we make people come see this? 3D!
No, it's
3D
and
explosions.
No,
yeah,
lots of explosions. The economic driving factor is China. China is 3D is marvellous, but the only Western films they will let in are big, mindless blockbusters that do not upset the political status quo. So that's why you're getting a lot of all explosion and no plot 3D blockbusters.
Mm-hmm.
Because,
every film is improved by an explosion, but.
Pride and Prejudice and Explosions.
Pride and Prejudice.
The bank is Pride and Prejudice and Zombies.
Yeah.
But I think I can't say one of the first 3D films I saw, because that was about 30 years ago. Of the recent relaunch, it was, I think the CGI of Angelina Jolie, Beowulf.
Oh, yeah.
And there's a scene, a fight in the Viking Long Hall, where for some not very apparent reason, the camera decides to do acrobatic loops around the rafters, up and down and around.
Michael
and sat there, and then, oh, you've thrown an axe at me at the screen. Oh, you've thrown a spear at me. What's coming next? Oh, it's an arrow. Right, you know. It was purely 3D for the sake of 3D, and it interfered with storytelling. But in Mad Max, I don't think it does.
No,
but
then again,
most 3D films, to be honest.
Yeah, it's one of those things, most 3D films, I find, that they're just there to sound. There's occasionally, you
you watch a 3D movie and it adds to it. I watched Avatar 3D, mm-hmm. and it made it deep. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was Jupiter Ascending.
Mm, yes.
You know, it's okay with
gravity.
Gravity.
You could
another
shout
one
at the physics in 3D.
Yeah. Add depth and size, and that was a subtle use. So
but
just
again,
even
I was
up
there
as
you can't see.
Yeah, I was going to say, the people who 3D filmed, after 5 minutes, my brain just goes,
you're
lying to me.
Your eyeballs
switch it off.
Yeah.
Excuse
me. I walk out of it feeling really good.
There are a real bugger if you wear very focal glasses.
Often the greatest problem is very focal.
Wrong
with
form of 3D information for what sort of vision they're doing stereoscopic vision, and that's for hand to eye coordination, not for big things on the move. That's not how you. It's a different way you go and process it. Do not crash into things on the motorway.
The thing is, even Avatar, it was a very pretty film, you know, it was really beautiful. But again, it's Pocahontas in space,
yes.
and it was criticised heavily for being very light on plot. You know?
But you didn't watch Avatar for the plot, you watched it for the wow scene.
Yeah.
But like Mad Max, you didn't watch it for the plot, you watched it for the explosions.
No, the basket bass guitarist with the
weird
stuff.
Yes, that was very much.
You know, you can get spray on silver food colours,
yes.
you do the crow.
Go on Amazon. It's a spray on silver, and look down at the responses from the buyers, because there's a whole bunch of Mad Max fans putting comments in as though they were the dogs. It's worth it.
Have you noticed, I would say, definitely over my experience in the science fiction industry, especially over the last 10 years, of they've run out of ideas, therefore we will now reboot a series. Star Trek, Doctor Who, rumour has it Galactica's coming back. You know, it's like, we've run out of ideas, let's just take the original series, reboot it, give it a good polish over and let it out again.
Don't forget the reboot of Danger House as well.
Oh, that's good. Cool.
It's fantastic.
Brilliant. It's definitely more prevalent in the movie side though. Have you noticed how much stuff he's just getting regurgitated with a new coating?
I think it's... I mean, I don't know. I don't have any facts or figures. But to me, it seems as if movie producers are becoming risk-averse.
Mm.
So they are going for things that are less likely to fail rather than things that are more likely to succeed. So making yet another Terminator movie or yet another, I don't know, whatever, based on a formula which already has been proven to be successful and has an existing fan base, is less of a risk than taking a new book and turning that into a film.
It's also economics and income stream. They own the Terminator franchise, therefore they get the money for the Happy Meals and the CDs and the toys and the games and everything. And it's the bean counter story. We could make that, but Gary would own the soft toy rights. Or we could make this where we own everything.
Yes.
It's also the whole thing about giving people enjoy what they enjoy and will return to it, which is why you like 5 books as opposed to one in the series. Why not just, and then later on you can reboot the same characters in another completely different way and into another series. And so it's the same as authors are doing, they're just doing on films. They're just going, it's so much easier. We know everybody likes Terminator, so let's make Terminator.
Do you think there are two sorts of reboots? Oh, sorry.
A steampunk question. I've been put off some steampunk that friends were raving about because it seemed to be all kind of top hats and parasols and going on back stairs. So I wondered what your views on kind of class and steampunk and which stereotypes are good for steampunk and which aren't.
Again, the sort of classic steampunk is, as you say, top hats and parasols and, you know, aristocracy, you know, lords and ladies living in mansions.
Yeah.
And you know, not a lot of focus on the upstairs and very little focus on the downstairs. I think, though, with a series like even Downton Abbey or any of those kinds of things, it's kind of revived the whole upstairs-downstairs thing. As a result, I think people are looking more at different classes. Certainly, I mean, you know, I sort of didn't want my protagonist to be upper class, so I've kind of made her a little bit more middle class, really, because you know, her dad is not a lord and they don't have a lot of money and that kind of thing. But again, you kind of give people what they want, you know, and it, you just have to balance it, I suppose. Certainly.
It's something I've noticed in reenactments. There's a lot more Victorian reenactments now than there used to be. We go to multiple periods. When you first go, you're just medieval and the American Civil War. You start to get Victorians. And it's that steampunk. And a lot of reenactors are science fiction fans. And usually, if you've ever been to any big medieval bashes or reenactment bashes, they always, they play the part, and then in the evening they all dress up. There's some friends wearing a t-shirt saying the clangers are in the mosh pit. But there's a lot of people who dress up in steampunk for that. Mm-hmm. But there's also, occasionally, we get reenactors who do the poor Victorians. Yes. So it is there, it's just...
Also, I think, though, that there's an element of fantasy to it. I mean, who wouldn't want to pretend that they were rich?
I can understand the cosplay, because you want the element of
So I think there's this element of pretending that you are a lady or a lord, and that you have... live in a mansion and, you know, have lots of servants. And
is this the grown-up version of all little girls wanting to be princesses?
Probably, you know.
It's also the ability to actually do something. If you're a clockmaker in steampunk, you're sitting at your desk, you're not actually getting up and walking around. If you're a lord, you can put on your hot top hat and go down and buy a ticket and fly to Paris or whatever. So it's the freedom, too, of the class structure.
It's always easier when you're rich.
Yes.
And I've been watching a lot of Paris, and he can just afford to buy a ticket to Paris, something like that. And us who actually live on a budget go, well, you're buying a day before, it's going to cost you a small fortune. It's probably a MacGuffin just to make it life easy. Do you find that you write yourself a scene, and then you realise, how am I going to get them there?
Yes, but I try and make things as difficult for my characters as I can, because, you know...
That much, I see.
Yes, you know, because otherwise, what's the point of writing a story? But I think there is that element of escapism, you know. It's kind of, I don't know about you, but I'm a huge victim of, administrative blunders, because week after week they publish the wrong lottery numbers. Over and over. No one wants to listen to me. I don't think there's a person here who wouldn't, you know, like to spend 5 minutes thinking about what would happen if they won the Euro Millions, you know? When you're writing a novel, what happens with the reader is they step into the shoes of your protagonist and they become that protagonist for the duration of the book. So, I mean, who wouldn't want to be financially independent and, or a lady of independent means, be able to have that financial and economic freedom. And so I think there's that element of escapism, which is quite probably needed.
In which case, are you writing a dystopian novel because you haven't won the lottery?
Yes.
Well, we've got a couple more minutes. Any last questions?
You said much earlier that you've got a lot of different projects currently in the mix. How do you stop them from influencing one another and leeching across and keeping them all as separate entities?
I just compartmentalise them. I'll be working on something now, I'll set the other ones aside and then I'll finish what I'm doing. So I've got two or three projects on the go at various stages of finality. Now it's literally just a case of switching your brain from one project to the next and then focusing on it. It's also quite nice because sometimes you get to, you're in the middle of a book and you sort of get to a point where you need to set it aside a little bit. Because certainly, I don't know, if my writing process is such that when I'm writing something, some days I just get to the point in a book where I need to let it be for a little while because my brain needs to come up with more. Where I've written faster than my brain can come up with ideas, so I need to sort of set the manuscript aside for a few days or a week just to get my thoughts and ideas up and running again. So it's quite handy in terms of the productivity perspective to set that project aside and then work on a short story or work on an outline for something else. I think it's not impossible to do. I don't think you could write two or three novels at the same time, because I think you'd go a bit mad, but certainly having them at various stages that you can work on is quite nice.